The following presentation was recorded at the 2014 Southeast Linux Fest in Charlotte, North Carolina. It is licensed under a Creative Commons license. For more information, visit www.southeastlinuxfest.org. The Southeast Linux Fest would like to thank the following diamond sponsors in 2014 for helping make these videos possible.
Now, without the mute button, we can head into our talk on Free Radius for AAA. I'll explain why the title isn't AAA in a second. But I like to start with who am I? I'm Joni Julian. I'm an Associate Director of Networking at UNC Chapel Hill. And actually, the next interesting part, my credentials for Free Radius. I didn't realize it until I went to basically fill in. Well, I've been using it for a little while, and I do remember that the first version I installed was 0.1. At the time, I had not done any research on how long has this software project been around. In fact, at the time, the way I picked Free Radius was we didn't budget to have a AAA server to go with this big Cisco VPN box we just bought, and now we've been told that's pretty much the only way we can do off-box authentication. And we're not going to take all 50,000 users and copy their passwords onto this box. So, eek, we need a Radius server right now. And, oh, by the way, the budget has to be $0. So, oh, and by the way, all of my servers at that time were Solaris running on Spark. So, by the way, it must compile on Spark. That key is how I picked Free Radius. I started with GNU Radius, had issues getting it to compile with Spark, which probably had to do with having some of my libraries in non-standard locations. Whatever. I spend a day with GNU Radius, didn't get anywhere. I spend a day with Free Radius, boom, I've got it up and running. And I went, we'll use Free Radius for this because I like something I can get to work. So I first installed Free Radius 0.1 in 2001. I knew it had been right around 2000. I went and checked the software releases. 0.1 was their first release, and it was released in 2001. So when I was doing the research for this talk, I realized, oh, I have been using this since the very beginning. Oh my. The best thing I can say about it is, in the whole time I've been running it, for maintenance, note the keyword maintenance, I've maybe spent one day a year maintaining Free Radius. You know, things like patching the operating system, I'm gonna do that on any of my servers. But actually paying attention to Free Radius, a little bit of time here, a little bit of time there, all of my problems have been fixed by restarting the process, rebooting the server, or it's not happy after I restarted the process. Let's see if there's been a new version released. There would be a new version, download, compile. Hey, look, it runs again. That is fantastically easy software. When you talk about all the little software pieces I run, I don't think I have any that are easier than this or simpler than this, at least not that I've built from source frequently. The keyword being maintenance. Every time we've added something else on, oh, hey, we've got that Radius server. Can we authenticate something else with that? Yeah, sure. Bringing something else up, some of the time that has taken me more than a day. Most of those actually were really simple, too. So again, this is, I was a little hesitant to propose this talk because I'm like, what do I really know about it? And then I realize I've been there from the beginning. I do know how to make it work. So what is Free Radius? It is the most widely deployed Radius server in the world. They're counting when it's been embedded in systems. And then you go, well, okay, great. What's a Radius server? Radius protocol supplies AAA services, which leads you to the very legitimate next question. What are my AAA services? The first A is authentication. It's frequently abbreviated auth. This is, in the simplest form, user and password. Of course, there are other ways to do authentication, but just as a definition. This is the user password. This username offers these credentials. Does that work for authentication? If you get a pass there, you go on to the next A, authorization. That's often written auths. The difference here is you've got the correct credentials. Now what are you allowed to do? What are you authorized to do? So that's the subtle difference that brings us over to authorization. I even have some coworkers who kind of blur the lines between auth and auths, and they are different. What are you allowed to do? The final A for AAA is accounting, that this user connected at this time for this long, they sent this many packets, it had this many bytes. I'm at a university, and guess what? I don't have to do the accounting. And this is why the talk is not free radius for AAA, which is what radius does. I've never turned on the accounting. I don't want anybody to think I'm qualified to speak on that. So that's why I put the X in for the final A. I don't know that. I can't imagine that it would be hard when the rest of it works well. So where do you start? That was certainly the first question I had when I looked at it, but it's so simple, it just worked. So install it, configure it. You are going to have to point it at, you know, authenticate against this backend. These are my users. So a little bit of configuration. It's really not painful. I'll dive into the configuration next. My first thought for step three was to say, well, was either to Ellipsis, Prophet, or just walk away, because it requires so little maintenance of me. Most of my software requires a lot more handholding than this. I decided to just edge out for run it. But there's a lot of, and then you can walk away. It's fairly hands-free after that. Back in the 0.1 days, and I think until the 1.x stream, you had to download the source, do your ./configure, make, sudo make install. And in my case, since I was using some of the, shall we say, lesser used libraries, it was actually configure, go change some of the flags in the make file for the Kerberos libraries, make, make install. But nowadays, although you can still get the source code and do it manually, there are so many pre-built packages. And I just grabbed from their homepage. We have packages for all of these platforms. Go forth and be happy. And I've certainly found, like now, my systems are Red Hat Enterprise Linux. I got rid of the Spark. Compiling has gotten much easier, thank you. And I just use Red Hat Network to get my packages. You know, so Red Hat Network puts it in for me, it's installed. And then I add myself to the Radius group that's automatically created. And then I can go in and poke the files the way I feel that I should without having to be root, which makes me happy. Now, I thought about it. If I were first looking at Free Radius today, I would start screaming, there's so many configuration files. Where do I start? Start at the main one, radiusd.conf. Back in the 0.1 days, all we had was radiusd.conf. And it quickly grew to 2,000 lines. That's a lot of configuration file to go through. And you start to feel a little bit tangled and confused and lost in there. So the good news was, hey, there was only one configuration file. The bad news was, have you seen the length of that configuration file? So I'm trying to promote the multiple configuration files. This is a good thing. Basically, large chunks have been ripped out of what used to be the one big radiusd.conf and been given a name. How do you know that? Read the radiusd.conf. You'll see a dollar include directive points to another configuration file. Go read that. The configuration files, all of them, have fantastic inline documentation. I have not often hit the man pages for this because I find the inline documentation is fantastic. That and Radius isn't my main job, so I'm usually like, let me get this running and then I can go back to the fun playing. Well, actually, Radius is pretty fun. I don't have to touch most of those configuration files. I will cover all of the ones that I commonly need to touch. So instead of saying, there's so many configuration files, there's about four that you care about. And since they've pulled out all the other parts you don't want to look at, they're easier to ignore. I do warn people to beware of major version changes, because every version has gone to simpler and more logical syntax. Well, what happens when the syntax changes on you? Even if it's a change for the better, whoops, your old stuff doesn't always work. And this is usually documented in line if you go look. So I'm very glad that in the 0.1 version, I started with the habit of leaving a note at the top. I've made the following changes. You know, I commented out this stuff. I uncommented this other stuff in the examples. Just make these changes. Because for every version, I would install the new version. I would grab my comments, paste them in the new radiusd.conf, and then follow those marching orders I had left for myself. Everybody has their own technique for this. Please use those. So let's jump in. How do we do it? I would say start by configuring the server. Start with the radiusd.conf. That is the master file. For the three main configuration files I want to talk about, I've got my, this is how you think of it, radiusd.conf. This is the heart of the server. So if you want to configure the server, start on this file. So my original notes were, I needed to add a host name. This was to make Kerberos happy. I was asked by my system administration group to change user and group to RadiusD, RadiusD, so they knew what was going on. They just wanted it to look like that. In the 0.1 version, they had not gone through the, oh, what do you mean we get an assigned port from IANA? And the old default port for FreeRadius was 1645. The actual IANA assigned port is 1812. So back in the old days, I knew what they'd been assigned. It shipped with 1645 as the default. I would change that to 1812. If you do have to do the accounting is traditionally one higher than the port FreeRadius runs on. So if they're connected to a NAS and you've got the accounting going on, it's sending those records back to FreeRadius on port 1813, unless you're running on 1645, in which case it sends it to 1646. I used to turn proxy off. We'll get into why I don't anymore. I would tell it to use syslog. A large number of what I have here, except for hostname, is now the default. And that's another amazing thing about FreeRadius. The way it ships out of the box is ready to run for almost everything. You know, make a couple tweaks to point it to your own stuff, and suddenly that thing is up and running. We'll cover this later in troubleshooting. So the next important file is clients.conf. And I tell everybody to think of this file as the application firewall. It's not the firewall for the server. It's at the application level. This file says what can talk to the FreeRadius server. And once my FreeRadius server got more and more popular, I laid down the edict of don't send me half a dozen, 20, 40 IP addresses. Tell me what subnet they're in and tell me what shared secret. Because not only do you have to be listed in clients.conf as an allowed client, you also have to present the correct shared secret. So there is authentication both by IP and do you know the shared secret to get in. So to give you an example, and all of this I have double, triple checked. I have changed all of the shared secrets. I have done copy and paste from my own config files and changed the shared secrets. This is a configuration block in clients.conf. You can either say client space IP address slash netmask, or you can give it a name to refer to. What you do have to assign, if you don't use the IP slash netmask, then you'll need to describe IP adder and netmask, what IP address is allowed to talk, what range. So I've written this against 152.2/16. The Shared Secret is a required field. This shortening, it's not a required field. When free radius syslogs, I saw the following connection from. What it puts after the word from is the short name. So in my case, I'm very fond of defining the short name. The short name is not optional. If you come to me and say, can I put this on your free radius server? Yeah. What's the subnet? Don't you dare give me a list of IPs. And what's the short name? And this is because I want the logs, if I need to troubleshoot it, I want the logs to make sense. And another optional field, you can point it out to a virtual server. We'll get into the virtual servers in a second. It's, again, this is not an IP tables sort of firewall. This is just for the application. This is not virtual servers in a VMware sense. This is just within free radius. It'll listen on the same IP address and the same port, but you can do some magic on. If you see the request come in from here, use this configuration to respond. If you see it come in from somewhere else, use a different configuration to respond. You don't have to assign the virtual server at this level, although I do. You can actually do it in other parts of the decision tree. So both very powerful and very flexible. I'll hold that comment till we get there. Also, when a client request comes in, if you define a /24 subnet, which would be more specific than a /16 subnet, and you have a request come in where both of these would apply, because this subnet applies to fewer hosts, it is the only shortening that will work. So you cannot have someone come in from this /24 with the shared secret of the /16. Only the more specific case will work. Yes, sir? Oh, the pound sign is comment. I've pulled that from the clients.conf file. The question was, what is the pound sign for? If you've noticed, I gave some IPv6 talks. So, of course, I'm going to have to take a moment to talk about the IPv6 readiness of free radius. It can do it. The problem I have is in the radiusd.conf, I can define IP adder equals star, IPv6 adder, :. This will listen on any v4 address. This will listen on any v6 address. Obviously, I could fill in something more specific if I needed to. The problem is you can do the IP adder, whole bunch of configuration, copy, paste that module block, and put in IPv6 adder. The problem doesn't come when you do the first copy paste. The problem comes when you come back that once a year to perform maintenance. And this is one of the problems I have had with free radius. If I only have to touch it for a couple hours every year, oh boy, when I go back and look at it, I'm sort of like, okay, how did I do this again? Hopefully I've left some comments for myself. If that's the worst thing I can say about this software is that I forget it between times I have to maintain it, that shouldn't really be considered a negative. I would really prefer to be able to have both of those directives in the same block so that if I make a change to the V4, I don't forget to make the change to the V6 and end up with different inconsistent behavior based on whether they're coming in on V4 or V6. So my preference would be to put it all in one. Bind does this for me. I can say listen on any, listen on V6, any. All in the same configuration file. And it gets all the same rules applied. So on the server side, I can get it to listen for either protocol. And on the client side, obviously whoever's connecting to the free radius server, if it's only listening on V6 and your clients are only V4, whoops, we have a problem. So in clients.conf, in the example before where I showed you IP adder, you could write IPv6 adder and fill it in. If you want a client to be able to connect on either V4 or V6, whichever one's up, whatever's working right now, you're going to have to duplicate that block again. So again, this is not my favorite way to be dual stack. I prefer it to be a little more in line. That said, just be aware of this pitfall. It does work for both. So we've done our authentication. What about authorization? Actually, we haven't done the authentication. That comes next. Authorization was simpler. This is the third of the immensely important configuration files for Radius. It's the user's file. And that's what usernames can authenticate. And sometimes you include what their authorization level is. So one example, when I was first setting it up, I had a friendly sysadmin down the hall come in and say, you're doing something that authenticates. Can I make a suggestion? And he looked at the inline comments in the code and came up with, I want you to have this be the first line, pretty please. We don't want someone connecting to the campus VPN claiming to have a username of root. We don't allow that for our users to select, and we don't want anybody to try something funny there. So root, authorization type, or authentication type, reject. Reject this out of hand. There is no way to get around this. And then send a reply message. He was sort of like, let's see if we can get anybody scared. Send the reply message of, your account has been disabled. And he just said, let's put that in as a safety so it'll never work. Okay, I like that idea. Another one, since our VPN was the first use of it, it wants to say users are in a group. So you could make example VPN group. And the way you define a clear text password, because of course this isn't going to be on our Kerberos server, is you say clear text password defined as, this is not the password. And if you needed to return, and if you first talk to someone and they say, oh, here's this appliance you want to buy, and you can authenticate with Radius, but you got to put users in a group. If you need to, our old VPN required this, the new one doesn't. You can send back group of example VPN group, whatever you've defined it to be, so that that works. If you put in something special, like if I wanted to give myself elevated permissions here, and we'll see several cases where I have given myself elevated permissions. If I wanted to give myself elevated permissions here, which I didn't need to do with root, you see root, reject, you're done processing the file. If I needed to set the group, you don't have to worry about that, but you do need to keep going on for a username. If I put myself in here, I would also have to, like where I've got group equals, I'd also have to put in fall through equals yes. And that would say, that's what you do for the username of Hope. If the username isn't Hope, go on to the next until you get a match. And then you can have the last line of default. If you wanted to have the equivalent of a default deny, you would say default auth type reject. If you wanted to have a default of allow, you would come down and it would be default auth type accept. You accept or reject the authentication. You can do an override. You can specify what the authentication type is if you want to go against an LDAP backend. Actually, I have another slide on this. There was, shall we say, a lively debate on the Free Radius mailing list about whether you should even be allowed to put anything after default. And the main developer of Free Radius, by the name of Alan DeCock, was on the side of, no, you should not be allowed to do that. You hit default and you let the server work its magic. Just, you know, let the magic fairy dust happen. I can see how he wants his software to be let to do the right thing, and it's amazing how it does do that. However, this ties in too closely to security for me, so I respectfully disagree with the lead developer. I want to have it fail. If you do not use the authentication type I'm expecting, in my case it's a Kerberos backend, if you're not using Kerberos, I don't want the server to try anything else. I want it to fail badly and log an error message that I'll go track down. I don't want unexpected. I want to know. I want my error message. I'll go fix it if I shouldn't have gotten the error message. But I don't want someone authenticating unexpected to me. Oops, can't hit the microphone. So what are my authentication modules? Yes, I threw authorization in there because it was a little easier. What are my authentication modules? Well, the first one I ever used was PAM, Pluggable Authentication Modules. The PAM library was simple enough that even as a grad student, I understood what it was, I knew where I was going, you know, I can make things in PAM work. I would look at an example that was already working, like secure shell to this box, copy it over, change SSH to radius. It was nice, easy, I could understand it. So basically, add radius D to etcpam.conf for etcpam.d radius D. Nice, simple. Go look at the examples in PAM to do that. That's the first one I used. However, in the 0 point number days of free radius, there was a memory leak in the PAM module. I don't know if it's still there because I haven't used it since the 0 days. Because of this memory leak, I got in the habit of, looks like it's about time to reboot this server or restart this process, typically. If I had also done patches at the same time, I'd be like, clean slate, we're rebooting. But I used to have to restart the process frequently. Well, somewhere between once a week and once a month, depending on number of authentications because of the memory leak. It really wasn't a fast memory leak. It wasn't that painful, but it was out there. I hope it's been fixed. I don't know, because next I went, we do have LDAP for authentication on campus. And in fact, I've used it on some servers that don't support Radius, so let me try LDAP instead for the backend. I took that same string I used to configure LDAP authentication for some of my other applications, threw it in the etc RedDB modules, that's the directory, the LDAP file. I put in server, and I put in the base DN I'd used everywhere else, and wow, it was amazing. Boom, just worked. And I thought I was so clever. I'd made it simpler. We didn't have to go through PAM, no more memory leak. I was feeling pretty good about this. Until, at a university, you say the word August with special meaning when all the students come in. And, things have been manageable over the summer. And then there's the fire hose and you've got a brick wall behind you. So August slams in and you're like, I'm not sure I was ready for August. And it was during that part of August when the students had returned that, I would phrase it as I got a knock on my office door, but my office door was open, and a very nice but large gentleman from identity management was standing there saying, are you using my LDAP server? Why, yes, I am. You're killing my LDAP server. Would you please stop it? And I said, I would, but I don't know how. And I explained, I have a memory leak in the PAM module, and LDAP is just so easy to configure. And he said, does it have a Kerberos module? And I said, yes, but I can't figure my way out around it. And he's sort of like, I can fix that. I will send someone who knows everything about Kerberos to sit with you. And I supplied the Radius knowledge, and John supplied the Kerberos knowledge. And in the short portion of an afternoon, we had figured out how to get the Kerberos module properly configured. Remember how back on the first RadiusD.conf slide, I had said, and I add in hostname equals whatever the hostname of that particular server is? That's so that I could make the Kerb5 configuration the same on all of them. The way Radius internally references its variables is dollar, curly braces, whatever the variable was. So I define it statically in the radiusd.conf, which is the file I do spend more time tuning. And then I could just say, and everybody's going to have the same Kerb5 configuration. I had to get a key tab assigned to my servers. I had to fill in the service principal with Radius slash what its host name was, because that's what they were putting in the key tab file. For that, I recommend asking someone who knows a lot more about Kerberos and not me. I was the free Radius portion of this. But all of those authentication modules, I'm changing like one or two lines and boom, suddenly they work with my infrastructure, which is pretty fantastic. So I said I would demonstrate how I give myself elevated privileges for Cisco for various things. If I'm logging in to Cisco switches or routers and I want to give myself more authorization, Cisco, like many vendors that support Radius as an authentication, also use radius for the authorization. So what am I allowed? So the first line says, my username is Hope. I'm authenticating with Kerberos, which means take what's sent, do the Kerberos thing, ship it out. And then what Cisco expects to get back, so whatever switch or router I'm logging into, they expect to get back user Hope, auth type accept, service type, administrative user. And that gives me full enable 15 privileges on the Cisco device. If you don't send anything, they can log in, but they can't run any of the commands that require enable unless they know the enable password. So the example of how to let them log in but not be able to make configuration changes is don't have that second line. This is log in and you've got full powers to everything. We used to buy Cabletron switches, then they became Enterasys, and they were just bought by Extreme. The way we authenticate to our Enterasys switches, because they still say Enterasys on them, again, I do my user ID, Hope, authentication type is Kerberos. What Enterasys expects to get back is a filter ID, an Enterasys version 1 management super user. I could also send back RO for read-only or RW for read-write, but not super user. In all of these examples, because, hey, I'm using myself as the example, I'm giving myself the maximum privileges. So this is how I do it for Enterasys. We also have a few Arista switches around. The way I do my authorization for that, same first line. Why Arista would put the name Cisco in, I don't quite know. What they expect to get back is Hope, accept, Cisco AV pair, shell, priv, level 15. Sounds like the level 15 from Cisco. And then service type, it's scrolled off. I've already forgotten. Again, what you do is you ask your vendor, what else should Radius return? And whatever it is they tell you, copy and paste that onto the second line. That's my rule of thumb for how to get around this. You don't have to understand it, just what do I need to do? Copy, paste that line in. You will probably need to put in double quotes around what it is, but other than that, just give it in the key value pair format. We also use Airwave for wireless management. So this is an application, another piece of software on another server. So I can also authorize against Airwave. This was fantastic because it got us out of the business of keeping local users and passwords on the Airwave server, and then someone's forgotten their password, we gotta change it for them. We can get out of that business by tying it to their Kerberized account. At that point, all I have to do is pick what role they belong in. And that you go to the configuration screen on Airwave, you look at what role names you have defined, and copy and paste, capitalization, spacing, all of that matters, into Aruba admin role, Aruba bought Airwave, equals, and whatever you named that role. And again, in the Airwave software, you get to pick that. We called our top level one AMP administration, and you send that back. That depends on how you've configured the server. And actually, Airwave has that nicely documented. The real problem, this is why I was emphasizing, that's the amount of time per year I spend on maintenance. Adding new features has occasionally been, again, I don't touch it very often, I forget about it between times that I use it. Adding new features has occasionally been a challenge. And in 2009, when we started it was when we were adding our 802.1x wireless. I needed to have the default line to make it work with the VPN. It needed to say default and nothing else. And the VPN was the first use of Free Radius, so it had some historical precedent. That line should say default. By the way, the main developer says that too. But in order to get our wireless to work, I've got that backwards. The VPN needed default auth type Kerberos. And that allowed me to say you will only use Kerberos. If someone manages to find and I didn't have any of those at the time, but if someone manages to find there's a local account on this server, they would have been able to authenticate to that if they'd had both the account name and the password. And that just made me nervous. I'm sort of like, just because I don't have those accounts, you know, if this box gets owned, they can add the account, they can add a password, they know both of it, then they can get in on the VPN. I'm not good with that. So I was really stick in the mud about, I want to keep that default line saying off-type Kerberos. But the wireless had listened to the developer say, oh no, that line should only ever say default. And there was that little problem of, I could make one of these work, but not both at the same time. And I went, what am I going to do? I kept running into this wall. I can't make them both work at the same time. I can't make them both work at the same time. Am I going to have multiple Radius servers? I really don't want to. Well, this 2009, they'd reached the 2.x branch, and they had just added the feature of virtual servers. And it turns out virtual servers are how you can do two contradictory things at the same time. Because I knew the IP range the VPNs were coming in on, and I knew the IP range the wireless controllers were coming in on, and they were different ranges. So I could say, if you're coming in as from a VPN, do the VPN thing. If you're coming in from a wireless controller, do the wireless thing. So exactly when I needed it, the feature I needed had been added, which harkens back to what I said. What have I done for maintenance on FreeRadius? I've either restarted the process or installed a newer version. Once again, installing a newer version came to my rescue. So the override, we'll see that on another slide, is the phrase update control. Override what the standard default is and add this. Yes?
Okay, so you were saying that you had a problem for Ethernet and wireless. So are you talking in virtual server terms two servers, or are you talking one server and maybe two profiles?
It's more like one server and two profiles.
Okay.
That's why I said this is not the VMware idea of virtual servers. It's not a completely different server. It's the same server. It's the same radiusd.conf. I've just said in the clients file, when you see a wireless controller come in, I know these are the IP ranges for wireless controllers. Send them over to this special configuration file. When you see VPN come in, we got a range of VPNs. But when you see that, send them over to this other configuration file. So the difference was I needed that last line in the user's file to say default. Well, I left that as the default, so I needed to, for the VPN, say, by the way, ignore that default, update it to we use Kerberos. We use Kerberos or fail badly. So I'll show you, I hope it's the next slide, where update control comes in. And this is where I'm discussing the flame war about, no, it should only ever be default. No, I have this corner case where I want to change it. And I really liked how the developer said it should be left as default because he wants his server to do the right thing because he wrote all the internal logic that figures out which authentication type is going to work. So I can see how he's very proud of that. It's amazing that it works. That was brilliant. But my sense of security is not, by the way, here's a laundry list of all these authentication types that work. Feel free to pick whichever one works. The thought of that just kind of, I'm not okay with that. I'm going to say pick Kerberos or fail badly, spit error messages everywhere so I can go, oh, what's somebody trying to do over here? So I appreciate that that loophole was left. So my Kerberos configuration, this is very standard. You look at, there's a file that ships with it called default. This is almost copy and paste from default, except that I've pulled out some of the authorization types, and I've added this block for update control, auth type Kerberos. And it knows that goes with the default line. You know, because I haven't put anything on it. So the default here is authentication type of Kerberos. And then the rest of it, oh, this is my other version of, I want you to fail badly if you're not using Kerberos. Usually in the authentication block, there's a couple different authentication methods to try, and they're listed in order. I removed all of those except Kerberos. I'm saying AuthType is called Kerberos. The module name is Kerb5. Everything else has been deleted. Why? Because I want it to fail badly and break. I want that. So my configuration magic is now I have to go through. I have different groups of users who are allowed to authenticate to Airwave for wireless management than are allowed to log in to Cisco routers, which is a slightly, very similar, but slightly different group from who's allowed to log in to the Enterasys switches. And you can see, you get some people who are allowed to mess with routers, some people allowed to mess with switches. Completely different group managing wireless. So I didn't want those to share a user's file. And unlike the VPN, anybody on campus is both allowed and, in fact, encouraged to use our VPN when they're off campus to work on campus. So for that, I don't want to call out usernames. I just want to say default Kerberos. If you've got a current login with a Kerberized password, you're good. You're fine. I don't want to know about it. I'm not going to call it out. That's how I run the configuration for the VPN. And since that was the first use, I've kind of left that as the default. I want to override that. I do not want everybody on campus logging into my switches. Oh boy, I do not. So I have to come up with ways to vary that up. And I'm going to use Airwave as my example. Within the radiusd.conf, I just call out, I want to call out some files, and I want to name this group of files. It's a group of one, but you have to address it as a group. So I call it files, good vibrations files. User's file is users.airwave. It will not look at the regular user's file. The regular user's file does not include users.airwave, even though my user's file example did say you could include it. Yes, you can. I don't. And then, do I need the Systron compatibility mode? No. You'll notice I've done some funny things with the names here. If you looked back at the previous slide, when I was doing a Kerberos example, I named the server Cerberus, the Greek name, instead. And then instead of calling this Airwave, I just went silly and called it Good Vibrations. Why am I doing this? That's because if they ever change how they do this, if they decide to ship an example file for this is how you would have a Kerberos virtual server, they're probably going to name it Kerberos or Airwave. And I want to be able to update my software. They're all Red Hat Enterprise Linux. We've got Red Hat Network. We've got a satellite on campus. I want to be able to run those updates and not have my files overwritten. This did bite one of my coworkers, so I'm very sensitive to this problem. I am choosing crazy names, not to be silly, although there's a streak of that. I'm doing that so there will not be a namespace collision. I am picking names that nobody's going to ship with a server they want taken seriously. And this is not only on purpose, this has been proven. The file name my colleague chose that was already in use was the one called default. And you cannot update all the packages on a machine when it needs packages and patches for security. If you've named the file default and that file already existed, guess what gets overwritten? Yeah. There was some swearing involved. And I said, I told you not to do that. So this is why I pick silly names, like Good Vibrations. It's not just to make me giggle, although there's certainly a good aspect of you may as well be amused at work when nobody else is ever going to see this. I can amuse myself and there will not be a namespace collision because it doesn't sound professional enough for anybody to ship that. So the simple virtual server I use, and again, the Cerberus one was also a virtual server. The one I use for Airwave, I just call the server Good Vibrations, authorize. Do all the pre-processing that I may have defined. I don't believe I've defined any. But if I ever do, do that. And then MyRadiusD.conf, we just saw that snippet where I defined good-vibrations_files to just include users.airwave. So in the virtual server, and they all go in a directory together called sites available. And there, I just call it out. So I call out good-vibrations_files. It says, oh, I remember what that was from RadiusD.conf. I'll do that. And all that said was include the users file. And then for testing purposes, I'm leaving PAP in as an authentication type. Not the most secure thing in the world, but I've got very tight control over what authorization gets sent back. So this allowed me to test it, but no, it would never actually show up on Airwave. This allowed me to test it on the Radius server's command line. And then authentication, my Kerberized users, or actually I had to leave PAP in. We left, we like to call in support, we pay for support, and we like to say, don't make me do all of that. You guys, y'all, go log into our server and tell us what's wrong. So we need to have an account for them, and rather than jump through all of the hoops of having them get a Kerberized account on our Kerberos servers that then they can't remember the password, I just fill in a, you know, user equals clear text password equals, and we agree on something that's hideously long and hard to remember. So it's written down on the Radius server for me. I'm sure they write it down on their side, and then they can log in. So I have to leave PAP there for that plain text authentication, and we don't actually use the post auth block. These are directives that appear in the RadiusD.conf. So you can basically pick and choose anything that's in the RadiusD.conf file and say, yeah, I want to tweak that for this virtual server, what FreeRadius calls a virtual server. I want to tweak that. All you have to do is take that block, whatever module it's in, and put it in something that says server, special name, that's what you call out in the clients.conf. Do these things differently. And this is how I'm allowed to say, I'm going to do it this way for the VPN and this completely incompatible way for the wireless controllers. But it's still one server, one collection of configuration files. I think this is fantastic. And I really hadn't put much configuration time into FreeRadius until we got to EAP, Extensible Authentication Protocol. And I spent far more time than I would care to admit to. It was just over a week, getting EAP working. It was, well, I ended up doing a lot of trial and error. Within the TLS module, so that means within the configuration file, it says TLS, open curly brackets, some directives, close curly brackets. Within that module, you have to fill in, I ended up changing private key password with the password that was on the certificate for the server. Private key file, that's pointing over to the private key. Certificate file, pointing to my certificate. And CA file, that was the bundle with our certificate authorities, root certs. So we had all of these certificates, and I had to tell the EAP.conf to point over there. Which, when you say it that way, makes taking a week to get all of this working happily sound not very impressive. That's why I'm saying, not sure I want to admit to that, but yeah. We just recently had to turn on proxy. I had always commented out using the proxy, which is you define everything to come into this Radius server, whichever one it is, or pair, or more than a pair, and all that Radius server does is essentially load balancing. I can farm it out to this one, or that one, or that one, or that one, and just return whatever I get from those back-end Radius servers. So it's got some primitive load balancing built in. I have tested, and it also works with our F5 load balancers. So I can do it at the network level on a load balancing hardware, or I can do it at the application level by running a proxy that then farms out all the requests. And at this point, you might be wondering, I wonder how much, you know, how heavy is Radius? In all the years that I've been running Radius, the server that it's running on, when I've had them on hardware and not VMs, has almost always been running at 0.1% CPU and little tiny, you know, hundreds of meg memory utilization for Radius D. So it is extremely lightweight in terms of CPU and memory. And then you go, so why are you starting to talk about how many Radius servers you have? And I have 6 in production and 2 that I test with. And you might be going, why on earth do you have that many Radius servers? Remember how I said I got to learn the hard way that the PAM module had a memory leak? Well, I also got to learn the hard way that the Kerberos module was single-threaded. FreeRadius itself is multi-threaded, but the Kerberos module is not used as frequently as, say, LDAP. So they put more development time into LDAP. I don't even argue with this as a development method, just I happen to be at a university where we use Kerberos, and oh look, that's a single-threaded module. Since it was single-threaded, and we have a large number of users, and they all like to use wireless, I was having to drop, well, not happily, but I was dropping wireless authentication requests due to the load, due to having to try to shoehorn it down a single-threaded Kerberos pipe. So how do you address that? Ring, you add more servers. So I did. Oh, so going back to this, the next thing we've added for wireless is using EduRoam. Don't know if you're familiar with EduRoam. It's credentials at one university, actually one Internet 2 participant will work on the EduRoam SSID at another Internet 2 participant, which is a pretty cool idea. And this is where we've decided we don't want the poor EduRoam folks to have to know every time we change out Radius servers. Hardware dies, we move it to a VM. They don't need to know this. In fact, they probably wish they didn't know this. And our first draft for EduRoam, they did know this, and they had to care when we changed it. So we threw up 2 proxy servers. All EduRoam has to know about are the servers we've named EduRoam 1 and EduRoam 2. This is basically pulled straight from the documentation, but I've put in fake IP addresses and fake secret. But yeah, pretty much we set up EduRoam 1, EduRoam 2. All they do is proxy. They don't have any of the special configurations. They proxy it to any one of the 6 servers that are actually up and running and ready for this. And they say, okay, I see this. You know, yes, they've got a current login and they gave the correct password, they're authenticated, or no, reject, they're not authenticated. So we are now using proxy. It was real easy. Proxy on, $include proxy.conf. Didn't have to change proxy.conf. Well, I had to throw in my servers, but no significant changes were made to turn on proxying. Really simple software. If you're interested in the EduRoam part, they have a Radius server configuration. They cover free Radius, and I forget what the other one was. It might have been, does Microsoft have a Radius? Some commercial Radius software, and most of their member institutions were either using free Radius or the other one. So those are the directions they give there. Géant has an EduRoam cookbook. You basically plug this in, make this change, you know, turn proxying on, do it this way. So they have a cookbook for that too, if you're interested in that. So far I've been hammering on, this stuff was so easy to get running, because really it was. There are times, however, when it gets fussy. And since they're usually pretty easy to deal with, let's talk about what you do when it gets fussy. I decided that I really probably shouldn't have elevated privileges on our Cisco routers when I logged into them. There are times when I need it. And there are times when I don't need it, and I would really like not to have that at that particular time. I don't want to shoot anybody in the foot. So I tried commenting out. Remember how it was just 2 lines? You know, hope, auth type, Kerberos, and then my Cisco administrative user. I tried just commenting that line out. I put a pound at the beginning of the line and said, and this will be good, right? And I hopped the server to get it to reread the configuration files, and I'm like, you know, life is good. I checked that the process is running after this. Okay, process is running. Less than 5 minutes later, but more than 1 minute later. You know, because I did the little bit suspicious, check it again. Okay, it's been a minute, I'll log out. And that's when the alarm came up and my system administrator is darkening my door. What did you do to kill the Radius server? I just commented out one line. And he's sort of like, well, take it out because you just killed the server. And in fact, he was right. I'm not quite sure why I couldn't have a comment at that point in the file, but I couldn't. I take the line out just like Sid told me to. Boom, server's happy, stays up. And that was actually a particularly nasty one in that the server did not die immediately. I'd kind of like it to die instantly or stay running forever. This anywhere in between I get a little twitchy about. But you have to admit, I probably was messing with its config files in a way it didn't like. So be nice to your config file, read the inline comments, and maybe try to match that. The other one we were bringing up, we had old hardware, it was starting to fail. We're bringing up a new Nagios server. And I just, you know, I wanted to have both running so we could have a smooth cutover. So both running at the same time. What do I name the second one in the clients.conf file? I called it Nagios Monitor 2. I had Nagios Monitor. We bring on the new one, I name it Nagios Monitor 2 with the numeral 2. Dang it, server won't start. And I am beating my head against the wall, you know, did I get any of the lines in there wrong? And then I sat down and I thought about it. I don't have numerals in any of my other client definitions, unless I'm writing out the whole IP address / netmask. Huh, since I don't have it in any of the named client sections, let me try taking those numbers out. I took it, and instead of being Nagios Monitor numeral 2, I turned it into Nagios Monitor 2. Hey, look, server worked. And that's one of those, but these are the smallest of hairs I'm splitting, honestly, compared to other things. So my advice here, if the server seems fussy to you and you want to yell at it, be patient. Follow the examples in the comments. Yeah, copy-paste examples and don't get too creative about changing the examples, like throwing in numbers where it doesn't want numbers. These are some of the worst problems I've hit, and it's not that bad. Now, the other side of the fussy. Some equipment freaks out when you send it an unknown, you know, this is what this user is allowed to have. We were looking at the Cisco file. In my group, the people who are allowed to log into the routers and the people who are allowed to log into the switches, that's a match. So I was sort of like, can't I combine all of this into one file? You know, and I'll call it users.networking, and everybody in the networking group can be in here. You know, so it'll be username, here's their Cisco privileges, here's their Enterasys privileges. Well, guess what? The Cisco gear likes to go belly up when it gets the Enterasys filter ID. Enterasys happily ignores the Cisco part, runs just fine. Cisco, very, very unhappy. So sometimes it's the other end that's fussy. Meh. I made a new virtual server for it. More fussiness. Our friend, RTFM. Read the comments, read the documentation. Documentation ships with it. There's a wiki. Ask Google, there's a mailing list, there's an IRC channel, you can even purchase support. And of course, your basics of troubleshooting. Is the process running? Number two, this is huge. Read the logs. It's fantastic about logging. Read your logs before you complain too much. And try the start, stop, or restart. If you think it's broken, this is in the documentation. I did not do this when I tried to do EAP. Learn from my mistake. Make one change at a time and then test it. And there's the rad test, username, password. You can put that command in, filling in a username and password that should work, and test it after you make each change. What it says on the wiki, run in debug mode, which is radius D-capital X. It's single threaded. It does more than what it would log. On screen, you can watch it all happen. That's how I got EAP working after I hadn't followed the directions about one change at a time. So that's why I say, seriously, I've done this the wrong way. Don't do it. And I've given you some links on how to do testing and monitoring and how to check on its performance. I don't worry about those much because 0.1% CPU utilization. If you're worried about that, follow these links. And I will minimize so you can see, so you can copy down the URL. With that, I'm done, unless you have any more questions. Talk about timing. Yes, I have 6 Radius servers. Okay, I have a pair of Radius servers because I want to be able to reboot and patch just for wireless users. And we'll get a concurrent peak of 16,000, but that's going to be within like a 5 or 10 minute range that we are getting those 16,000 users. Our VPN, we had our peak concurrent usage during an ice storm. And again, we have another pair of servers there just so we can patch and reboot one. The VPN will fail over to the other. Those people tend to wake up and get online at different times. That one doesn't get very high load. And then we have a pair for us to use internally for switches, routers, Airwave, anything else that uses it. So none of those 3 pairs gets very much load. The busiest pair is obviously the one for wireless users because class gets out, a student stream out, and they're pulling out their phone. So that's when we get our 16,000 peak concurrent users. And that server can handle the 16,000 with no problem. So I don't have bigger, they all peak at once for you than that. But it does that with the same piddly low numbers. More questions? We're going to go out to play.
Your customers rely on your website or application. If it's slow or non-responsive, it infuriates your users and costs you money. Keeping your business-critical systems humming along requires insight into what they're doing. Your system metrics tell stories, stories that can reveal performance bottlenecks, resource limitations, and other problems. But how do you keep an eye on all of your system's performance metrics in real time and record this data for later analysis? Enter Longview, the new way to see what's really going on under the hood. The Longview dashboard lets you visualize the status of all your systems, providing you with a bird's eye view of your entire fleet. You can sort by CPU, memory, swap, processes load, and network usage. Click a specific system to access its individual dashboard, then click and drag to zoom in on choke points and get more detail. Comprehensive network data, including inbound and outbound traffic, is available on the Network tab, and Disk Writes and Free Space on the Disks tab, while the Process Explorer displays usage statistics for individual processes. The System Info tab shows listening services, active connections, and available updates. Adding Longview to a system is easy. Just click the button, copy the one-line installation command, then run the command on your Linux system to complete the process. The agent will begin collecting data and sending it to Longview. Then the graphs start rolling. Use Longview to gain visibility into your servers, so when your website or app heats up, it stays up.